Hi, Sandro here. All right, so we are at the ski domain Belalp, and I'm going to show you the impossible ski lift.
Skiing is by far my favorite winter sport. The main thrill, of course, is the action and speed adrenaline. The breathtaking views accompanying you everywhere are another key to the happiness this sport brings. And for bonus, you don't even have to perform the hard work of ascending the slopes yourself. Powerful machines bring you up the mountain with ease and comfort. Always since I've been a little child, those mighty machines have been fascinating me. Hundreds of parts, all connected through an infinite rope, form a seemingly endless, moving, humming, rattling structure, often powered by just a single motor that drives the whole huge thing. Sometimes the motor is so far away you cannot even see it, and yet it drives every single moving part. In contrast to modern high-tech ropeways and chairlifts, good old-fashioned ski lifts expose almost all of their moving parts to the naked eye. They are simple to understand and yet often the result of some pretty smart engineering. The principle is simple. A central motor powers a rope which carries T-bars in a loop. People board on the bottom and release the T-bar on the top. Then the T-bar is carried back down again for the next usage. Wheels on masts are used to alter the rope's direction such that the rope follows the terrain. The most interesting part for this video is how the T-bars are attached to the rope. Here is a picture of an old-fashioned chairlift. It's fixated to the rope in the same way as a T-bar, but larger. As you can see, the clamp is shaped as flat as possible. The wheels guiding the rope can pass under the clamp, allowing the chair or T-bar to descend. This way, the rope can be brought into a convex shape at the location of a mast. Due to the flat clamp shape, concave shapes are also possible, allowing the skilift to adjust to steeper terrain. The clamp slightly bangs against the wheels, producing a characteristic sound. In order to reduce the shocks and to make sure that the rope always keeps contact with the guiding wheels, each wheel moves individually, leading to greatly satisfying slow motion shots. But wait! At the bottom and the top of the lift, the direction of the rope must be altered horizontally as well. Since the clamp only grabs the rope from one side, that's not a problem. The only thing we need to make sure is that the clamp is always on the outside of the wheel. This way it does not get into the way of the wheel. Thus a ski lift can only turn into three directions: up, inwards, and down. By making it rotate clockwise or counterclockwise, you can decide whether it should turn left or right on the top or bottom. Building a ski lift that can take turns left and right would, however, seem impossible, because at least at one of these turns, you would need to place wheels on the side of the rope where the clamp is. Then the clamp would crash against the wheels. It would derail the rope and the passengers would fall to their certain deaths. You can cheat a bit, of course. This ski lift at Bürchen has a very slight curve in its middle. On the side going up the mountain, the curve is going inwards. All is good. On the descending side, however, the T-bars need to be forced into a curve going outwards and the clamp gets in the way. You can see in this shot how every clamp slightly bangs against the wheels and the T-bar is sent swinging by the impact. If the curve was more pronounced, this would become a serious problem. This is a ski lift located at Chäserrugg. It has a more pronounced curve, thus the T-bars coming back down would have to follow an outwards curve that is too pronounced. To avoid this, the builders of the ski lift decided to let the descending T-bars take two sharp inward turns instead. Go ahead and observe a T-bar as it moves down from the top right corner of the video, which I'm speeding up a bit. After the first turn on the topmost wheel, the T-bars are aligned with the lower part of the ski lift. But since the turn was inward, they are now moving up and need to take another 180-degree turn in order to proceed into the correct direction. The resulting construct seems to be coming from an animated sci-fi movie and offers a delightful view to every engineer. However, the solution to the outwards curve problem can only handle right turns of the ski lift. The T-bars must be raised several meters above ground, which limits this solution to the descending lane. It would not be possible to apply this principle to the T-bars carrying people. In the horizontal plane, this ski lift can only take right turns when ascending. Now, let's go to the ski domain of Belalp in the Swiss Alps. They have a ski lift called Hohstock, built in 1982, which should be physically impossible. It has two horizontal curves. The lower one takes a sharp left turn, and the upper one a less sharp but still pronounced right. It also has both convex and concave turns in the vertical dimension. A ski lift that turns in all four directions. None of the solutions from the ski lift shown earlier could handle this challenge. They all turn in just three directions, a single one in the horizontal plane. So how can a Hohstock lift turn in all four directions? Question to the viewer, how would you do it? Let me say so much. Their solution is so simple, it seems like a child could have come up with it. But despite or maybe because of its simplicity, the idea is absolutely genius. So if you like, take a moment, pause the video and think about what would be your approach to tackle this problem without requiring expensive novel technology or shapes. Alright, here comes the solution. The Hohstock ski lift actually has two almost parallel ropes. The T-bars connect to both ropes through a pretty unique piece that has a T-like shape. At first sight, this seems to be a bad idea because it makes the T-bars harder to grab as you board the lift. However, the system allows the lift to redefine what outside means. Note how the ropes were at the top of each other at the orange wheel. As the T-bar moves on, the connector is rotated by 90 degrees because already at the first mast, the ropes are placed horizontally. Where there was a top and bottom rope, now there is an outer and an inner rope. Here is some footage of the right as we approach the first curve, a left one. Between the masts, the rope switches to vertical and the outer rope becomes the bottom one, causing the T-connector to be to the right of the ropes. A sharp left turn can now be taken without any problems, because the connector sits on the right, the outer side of the curve. After the turn, the ropes become horizontal again. This allows the ski lift to take vertical turns in both directions, convex and concave. Approaching the next horizontal turn, the ropes go vertical again, but this time the inner rope takes the place at the bottom. The connector now sits to the left of the ropes and the ski lift can effortlessly take a right turn with the connector sitting on the outside. And if that wasn't enough awesomeness, the ski lift even has a hovering mast. No kidding, the thing is actually hung onto the surrounding mountains. These amazing features make the Hohstock lift my absolute favorite. It's also the last of its kind. For more info and technical data, check the link in the description. But wait, there is more coolness. At the top of the lift, there is a tunnel. The 150 meter long hole leads straight through the mountain to the other side. There, splendid beauty and a really nice slope awaits snow-hungry skiers and snowboarders. Now, if you'll excuse me, I got a slope to hit. Thanks for watching and have a nice day. Bye-bye.